Thus far in the course, we've really laid the basic ground rules down to really start getting into the way things are really done in the real world. And most of what's done in the real world is actually based on this concept of sampling distributions, which we could not begin to understand without everything we've already gone through and worked with. Now, as usual, let's take a look at the learning objectives, what we want to make sure we get out of these next several videos. First of all, we want to be able to understand the similarities and the differences between a population distribution and a sampling distribution. The whole key here is sampling distributions. And these differences, or how they relate to each other, is extremely important. And that fundamental understanding will help carry you through, or literally, the rest of the course. Now, we want to use the central limit theorem, so we will describe the central limit theorem. To describe sampling distributions, the central limit theorem is an incredibly important theorem, and it allows us to do things that we couldn't do otherwise. And I don't want to talk too much about it now, we're about to get into it, but pay particular close attention to this idea of the central limit theorem. And we want to compute probabilities associated with a sampling distribution, which will quite often rely back on the central limit theorem. And we want to be able to understand the relationship between a sample size and the standard deviation of the sampling distribution. There's definitely a connection there. So let's start off here discussing the idea of a sampling distribution, the sample statistic. Now, here's the basic concept. So suppose that we have a population of size n. We use capital N to represent the population size. That's capital N. Now, if you take all sample sizes of size n, it's a little n, the lowercase n is our sample size, and we calculate the sample mean, that means x bar, from each sample. And then if we look at the distribution of the sample means, all those means you just calculated, you just establish the sampling distribution of the sample mean. So let's think about this for a second. If I take a bucket of numbers and I dump it on your desk and say, all right, tell me what you can tell me about the distribution of these numbers. Well, you do the typical sort of stuff. You would probably calculate the average x bar. You would find s, the sample standard deviation. You'd probably make some histograms, maybe a box plot. You may look at, obviously, if you did a box plot, you look at the five number summary. All this describes a distribution. You'd use a box plot and the histograms to describe the shape, and numerically, the mean and standard deviation, and possibly the median, give us numerical summaries of the distribution. So, what if I now told you that that bucket actually contained means? Every one of those numbers that you just worked with was actually a sample mean. So what you did is you took the sample mean and found the mean of the sample means, x bar bar. You know, when I said those are just numbers, you said it was x bar. Well, if each number happened to be an x bar, then the average of all those averages would be x bar bar. So, well, let's go back to this for a second. So you define the average of the averages, you define the standard deviation of the averages, you'd still look at histograms. Box plots, you do the exact same thing. The only difference is rather than these numbers being individual values, x's, each value, each x, is actually a result of a sample. So each x is actually an x bar. So here is a population of capital size n. So let's just suppose for a moment that our sample, little n, is 3. I'm picking these numbers. 3, so that it's small enough I can work with it in this little discussion. If I picked a sample size of like, you know, 37 or 100, there's just no way I could work with it. So, what does it mean to take all possible samples? If you take all possible, well, what's it mean to take a sample of 3? Well, this could have been my first sample of 3, right? And from that, I would get an X bar. Let's call that X bar 1. And this could have been my next sample of 3. Let's call that x bar 2. And then this could have been my next sample mean. I call that x bar 3. And then this, my next sample mean. call that X bar 4. And I think you can see that this is going to take a long time just to get this far. And then once I got all the way down here, I would start over and say, well, gosh, this could have been my sample mean. That would be X bar whatever, K. And then this could have been my sample mean, you know, X bar K plus 1, and so forth. And that would take a long time. And then I would start over and say, well, gosh, this could have been. And see what's happening as I'm methodically going through here and I'm picking every possible sample that could that you could get out of this population of N. Now, something could be very, very apparent here to you, or should be very apparent. The combination, all possible combinations here of 3 are going to be larger than the population size. So you never really do this. It doesn't make sense to ever actually do it. Other than if you had a small population, it might be a nice academic exercise. But to do it in the real world for real analysis, you just never, ever, ever do it. It won't make any sense. Well, you don't have to because the theory for this has already been established. Now, the key is if you actually did this in theory, each of these X bars is like a number in the box or in the bucket. Every one of these is just a number. So if I look at the distribution of all these X bars, I've actually established the sampling distribution of the sample mean. Sample mean because these are sample means. The sampling distribution is because I took all these different samples and I'm looking at the distribution of the result of each sample. Hence the term sampling distribution of the sample mean. Now, if we know the parameters that specify this distribution, if we actually know the parameters, then we can calculate probabilities based on the distribution. What that means is that rather than, like in the previous chapter, we calculate the probability of one person surviving longer than 8 years, giving you know the parameter values for the survivability of whatever disease we're talking about, now we could talk about the probability that the average survival time is greater than whatever it is that we're interested in. See, that's much more useful. If we're talking just for a moment about the idea of survival times, do we really care how long one person survived? I mean, I'm not trying to sound cold or cruel here, but the bottom line is, no, we don't. We're testing this drug, and we want to know typically what happens. Well, the result from one person is not going to tell us typically what happens. The result of one person won't tell us if this drug is working or not. Whether it's making people live longer, whether it's curing them, or whether it's killing them. We can't tell from one person, but we can tell from an average. So if we took a sample from this population of people with this disease and calculated averages, that could have represented our sample. Our sample average would be somewhere in all these possible averages. So now I can talk about the distribution of these averages, and I can talk about the probability of the average survival time being greater than or less than or whatever it is that we're interested in. Now, if we do this type of thing, 3 very interesting and very important things happen. Number one, it doesn't really matter what the parent distribution is. The parent distribution would be X, the survival of each individual. It makes no difference whether that distribution is normal, skewed right, skewed left, bimodal. It's not relevant. The average of all the sample means will be mu, the true average. So up here, if I do all these averages and I find X bar bar, the average of all the X bars, this is actually the same as mu, the population average. And that shouldn't be too hard to convince yourself of, considering I use every value in the population in here. The variance of the sample means will be sigma squared, the variance from the population, divided by N, the sample size. Now, quite often we write these as mu x bar, saying this is the true average of the sample averages, this of the sampling distribution, and this is sometimes abbreviated as sigma squared x bar. So this is the variance of the sample averages. Doing this tells me that it's really sigma squared from the population divided by N. It's just different notations that when you see this notation, you understand what it means. So this is the first thing that is very, very important. The next thing that's extremely important is if the parent distribution to begin with, if it was normal, if I knew that X was distributed normal with some mean and some variance, if I knew that, then the sampling distribution, the sample means, will also be normal. In other words, I know that X bar will also be normal. The mean will still be mu, like we said right there. But the variance, rather than sigma squared, would simply be sigma squared over n. So we need to introduce the actual sample size that has an effect on the variance from the distribution. So again, if we know that the parent distribution, the population distribution, is normal, that implies that this is also true. This is the distribution of the sampling distribution of the sample mean, if we know the distribution is normal. Well, not all distributions are normal. Not all populations are normal. Matter of fact, the number of populations that are normal compared to non-normal is really probably very minuscule. Most distributions really are not normal. So now what? Well, if the sample size is large enough, then this thing called the CLT, which stands for the central limit theorem, the central limit theorem will apply. And if it applies, then we can make the assumption that X bar is distributed normal with a mean of mu and a variance of sigma squared over n. This is exactly what we said up here. But up here, we had the idea of normality. We knew the parent distribution was normal. Well, if the parent distribution is not normal, the parent distribution is distributed, and I'm making up this notation, this is not real notation, something, but we know the mean and the variance, but we don't know what the actual distribution is. If the sample size is large enough, then we can make this conclusion and say that the sample means are actually normal. That's incredibly powerful. But one of the big questions is what does it mean to be large enough? Or a large enough sample size when we're dealing with sample distribution of the sample mean. Okay, this is just for the sample mean. We're about to look at proportions down the road here a little bit, and it's a little bit different. For the sample mean, it's considered to be at least 30. Now, this is really nothing more than a rule of thumb. I mean, it's a guideline. It's not some law carved in stone. If I have a distribution, I'm sorry, if I have a sample where, say, n equals 29, strictly by the book, CLT won't apply. But I know better than that from experience. I'll take a look at that distribution. If it looks reasonably symmetric, 29, I'm sure, is plenty. It's not a big deal. Because remember, if the distribution is actually normal, then the sample size didn't matter. Let's go back up here for a second. We said if the population was normal to begin with, then did we say anything about the size of n was to make this happen? No, it just automatically happened. You could have a sample size of 2 and it would work because the parent distribution is normal. So remember, the normal distribution is that bell-shaped curve, incredibly symmetric. So if I look at a distribution and it looks reasonably symmetric, not necessarily even bell-shaped, but reasonably symmetric, then I'm not too concerned if I have a few less than 30. It's not a big deal. And likewise, if it's some horribly skewed distribution, it's heavily skewed thing, 30 is probably not going to be enough. As a general rule of thumb, we say, yeah, it's what we see empirically. It starts to happen at that point. But it's not necessarily a carved in stone. It's not that you're guaranteed at 30 it will happen, and at 29 it will not. It just doesn't work that way. Now, the central limit theorem is one of the most important, if not the most important, theorems in all basic statistical analysis. And the reason is because it does not depend on the parent distribution. And just to make sure you're with me, whenever I say parent distribution, I'm talking about the population distribution. It does not depend on how the population is distributed. And because of this, we can find probabilities for sample means, which is typically much more useful than finding a probability for an individual. Regardless of the parent distribution. That is extremely, extremely powerful. What this says is, you don't have to know the parent population. You don't have to know that distribution. You do need to know some parameters. You do need to know mu, whoops, it's supposed to be mu, not mu squared, sorry. There we go. You do need to know mu, and you need to know sigma squared. You have to know these parameter values. But regardless of the parent distribution, if the sample size is big enough, the central limit theorem gives us a way to find probabilities. Remember, a very, very key point is that you must have a distribution to find a probability. You absolutely must have it. No distribution, no probability. And that's extremely important because we make decisions based on probabilities. So we have to have a way that we can find a probability.